Good afternoon. Welcome, everyone. I also want to welcome all of the members of our family that are watching the live stream and that will be watching the recording of the presentation. This is a presentation about Stamper Gardner. Stamper was a private in Company C of the 6th Regiment, U.S. Colored Cavalry. He was my fourth great uncle, and he led a really remarkable life. He lived half of his life, more than half of his life, enslaved, found freedom as a soldier in the Union Army, and nearly gave his life fighting in battle at the Second Saltville Campaign. And after that, although he no doubt lived his life in a lot of discomfort and pain from the injuries he sustained during the war, he lived out a great life as a farmer, lived in peace, and ended up owning at least 500 acres of land. So this is his story, and it's my pleasure to be able to tell it today. So I remember sitting at my computer at the desk when we made the connection between Uncle Stamper and the African-American Civil War Memorial. And I remember my first reaction when we made that connection was, wow, this is fantastic. We have an ancestor whose name is on a monument in our nation's capital. What a great thing. My second thought was, I can't wait to get to the museum and get to the memorial to check it out and make the connection as we did. We found Uncle Stamper's name on Wall A, plaque 15 at the memorial. And then my third thought was, how did it take me so long to figure out that Uncle Stamper was part of our history? So I spent half a lifetime figuring out that Uncle Stamper is our relative, our ancestor. But the little bit of regret that I felt about the amount of time it took, that quickly went away when I was examining the records more and realized that Uncle Stamper had lived more than half of his life as an enslaved man. And I weighed those two problems and decided that mine, in comparison, wasn't even a trivial issue. As we get started, I want to thank the museum. This is a special little place, and it has a great program called First Saturdays, which allows descendants of Civil War ancestors to come in and give presentations and talk about their ancestors and to share their voyage of family discovery and how they found their ancestor. So it's really my privilege to be here as part of that program. I also want to thank my daughter, Lillian, and her and her fifth grade teacher, Carrie Rowling. It was about 2 years ago at this time when Ms. Rowling sent Lillian and her classmates home with a very ambitious family history project. And it was that family history project that kicked off our journey of discovery that led to finding out about Stamper and a number of other very interesting things in our family history. I also want to thank my cousin Jim Jackson and David Reed. Unbeknownst to me, while I was pursuing our research and diligence into our family history and making discoveries about Stamper, cousin Jim had done that years ago. He had done extensive research about Stamper and other members of the family and paid numerous visits to Eastern Kentucky, the sites of some locations that are very significant in our family. And our cousin Dave Reed put the two of us in touch with each other so that we could work on this project. And Jim was very gracious in sharing all the information he had and everything that he knew, which enabled me to put together this presentation. Finally, I want to thank all of you that are here to be part of this, and I hope this presentation, and for those of you that are listening on the live cast and will be listening in the future, that it inspires you to make discoveries about your family. Let's start with our lineage to Stamper. So there are quite a few things we know about Uncle Stamper, but there are some really important things that we don't know. One of the most important things we don't know is, what did he look like? We don't know. And when you think about having a tangible connection to an ancestor, what's the most tangible connection you can have to someone you've never met or someone who's no longer living? Typically a photograph, right? But in our case, the most tangible connection we have with Uncle Stamper, I think anyway, or one of the most tangible, is his grave marker at the Peck Cemetery in McGoffin County, Kentucky. Now, the grave marker is a Union Civil War veteran marker. It's blurry in this photograph, but you can still make it out. It says Stamper Gardner, CO, C. CO is abbreviation, obviously, for company. Company C, six U.S. colored cattle. So that's where we start in our lineage with Stamper. We know, fortunately, that Uncle Stamper had a wife. Her name was Polly Ann Howard. And we found out about her when we looked through Uncle Stamper's pension file from the National Archives. And we found in the pension folder this little gem of a letter that Polly Ann wrote from Dayton, Ohio, where she was living at the time in 1928. It's a letter she wrote to her congressman asking for a pension, a Civil War widow's pension. And this letter is important not because she was requesting a pension, but because all these years later, of the important biographical information it reveals about her and her life with Uncle Stamper. So she writes, "I am the widow of Stamper Gardner, who was a Civil War veteran. I married him in McGoffin County, Kentucky. Salyersville is the county seat. My name was Polly Ann Howard. He joined the Union Army after we were married, about the year of 1863. I was married in my master's house, Ben Howard. I hope to hear from this that I am entitled to a pension." So we know a lot now, right? We know where they were married, we know when they were married, and we know who Polly Ann was enslaved to. And those are very significant facts, and we're not going to give up on our search and our diligence and holding out hope that we will eventually find a photograph of Uncle Stamper and perhaps even of Aunt Polly Ann as well. We know Uncle Stamper had a brother, a younger brother. His name was Greenville Clay Gardner. Green is my third great-grandfather, and we have a photograph of Green. This serious-looking, distinguished gentleman in a suit, that's Grandpa Green. And as you can tell, perhaps by looking at this photograph, if you examine it closely, it's a photograph of a campaign pin, right? And at the top it says, "For Coroner, G.C.," and at the bottom it says, under his photograph, "G.C. Gardner." So we know that at some point in his life, probably in the 1880s, Grandpa Green ran for elected public office. Grandpa Green married Elizabeth Cockrell, Betty Cockrell. Betty is a Cherokee, a Native American, and together they had 9 children, including Sally Mae Gardner, my second great grandmother. And as you can see from the 1880 federal census from Breathitt County, Kentucky, Uncle Stamper was living with his brother Green and their family at that time. They were part of the same household. And that household included Sally Mae when she was about 12 years old. And I'm sure, based on what we know about the discomfort and pain that Uncle Stamper was no doubt suffering under from his injuries from the war, it was a great comfort to him to be living with his brother and his brother's family. And I suspect that Grandpa Green felt a great debt of gratitude to Stamper and to the other soldiers who fought for their freedom so that Grandpa Green could try to fulfill his aspirations for political office, something he couldn't have done previously. So at about 18, Grandma Sally married William Smith Reed, and they had 4 children, including my great-grandfather, Chester. Now I need to digress for just about 30 seconds on Grandma Sally, because from everything we know and read about her, she was an absolute force of nature. And a wonderful woman, very popular, very well known, and highly respected by everyone in the community. And you don't have to take my word for it, because this is the article that the editors of the Salyersville Independent put on the front page of their paper after she died. And this is what they said about her. They said, "Her life was an example of what one with limited opportunities may do. Born of a race that has been the subject of white prejudice since the oppressive days of slavery, Aunt Sally so endeared herself to the people that creed and race and color were all forgotten, and she was an inspiration to all the people who recognized in her a Christian character worthy of the utmost respect. No person who has ever lived in this community, black or white, will be missed more than Aunt Sally." So, you know, really quite a remarkable statement about her. And so obviously Green and Betty raised a really wonderful daughter, and we should be proud to have her as our great grandma. So Grandma Sally's son, Chester, married Flossie Benson. And they had 10 children. 8 of those children survived into adulthood. And they were Clay, Chester Jr., Lillian, my grandmother, Dorothy, Lilburn, Virginia, Mary, and David. And this is a photo of Chester and Flossie on their wedding day in 1912. And a great photo of all the children. So Lillian, my grandmother, married George Williams. And let me just say, George and Lillian were everything you could hope for in grandparents and more. And I'm sure if you ask their children, David, Claudette, Reed, and Loretta, they would say the same thing about them as parents. And I want to thank my Aunt Loretta for this wonderful photograph of these four very handsome kids. David, Claudette, Reed, and Loretta. And my father, David, married Sheila McCarty. And they were married in 1961. And shortly before that, back in 1959, when my mother graduated from high school, she was famous for about a week across the U.S. There was an Associated Press article and photograph that went out about her that was published in papers all over the country. And she was famous because she went 13 years of school from kindergarten, listen to this, kids, from kindergarten to 12th grade without ever having been absent or late. She wasn't even late once. And so she was famous for about a week nationally because of that accomplishment. And our parents, Sheila and David, had 5 children, Marcy, Shonda, Brendan, Heather, and me. And I want to pause for a second because I hope this description of our lineage, as I bring this back to Stamper, will enable as many branches of our family tree, cousins, aunts and uncles and others, to see where they fit in on the tree going back to Grandpa Green and to Uncle Stamper. I also want to say at this point that our voyage of family discovery has been very special. There were things that we knew about our family, things that we didn't know about our family. So let's talk about that for just a minute, okay? So on our father's side, we knew that we were descended from enslaved African American and Native American peoples, right? That wasn't a surprise to us. But finding out about Uncle Stamper, that was a real blessing. On our mother's side, we knew we were descended from Irish immigrants who left Ireland in the mid-1800s because they were poor and wanted to make a better life for themselves here in America. But what we didn't know on our mother's side is that we were also descended from at least 8 great-grandfathers who fought for America in the American Revolution. So we were very pleased to find out about that. But we were, I would say, more than displeased to find out that 3 of those great-grandfathers owned slaves in New York, New Jersey, Connecticut area in the late 1700s, early 1800s, before those states outlawed slavery. So I think it makes our lineage very unique, and our heritage very uniquely American, to say the least. But through all that, you know, and despite what we knew about our family, all of us together, what we didn't know, our parents always kept it simple for us, right? What did they teach us? They taught us to be proud of who we are. They taught us to respect other people for who they are. And they taught us that when you get right down to it, everybody's the same. Everybody wants to live out their family lives as best they can. Everybody wants to have a good job, to have a career that they care about. They want to be free to engage in the civic life of their community, have good schools for their kids, and to be able to leave their kids better off than they were. That's what it's all about. That's the same lesson our grandparents, our aunts and uncles on both sides of the family taught us. And how did they teach that to us? It wasn't through a bunch of lectures or talk that kids don't listen to anyway. It was by how they lived, by their actions. That was the best way that they taught us. But that all started with us having the freedom to do those things. And we've had our freedom all our lives. I think it's so ingrained in us that we have no idea what it would be like. We can't even begin to appreciate what it would be like without those freedoms. But Uncle Stamper, as I mentioned, lived half of his life or more as an enslaved person. He didn't get his freedom until he made his way at age 34 to Camp Nelson, which started off its life as a supply depot to provide support for Union raids into Tennessee. But it quickly became known as a very important gateway to freedom for 10,000 African American men who enlisted, got their freedom, and learned how to fight, and then went out and fought as part of the Union Army to secure their freedom in their futures. It was also a refuge for their families, their wives, and their children. They needed to make sure that they were safe from bounty hunters, vengeful slave owners, from the elements. And so they made their way to Camp Nelson too, and started to eke out a living, providing basic services to the troops in the camp. Camp Nelson is now it's a Civil War heritage park. It's a place that all of us can visit, and it was recently designated as a National Historic Landmark. I plan to visit sometime, hopefully very soon, and I hope others in our family do the same. We can talk to Cousin Jim, because he's been there a couple times. So, as I said, Uncle Stamper enlisted at Camp Nelson, and here's his enlistment certificate. It's a little bit blurry in this photo, but I think the enlistment certificate and what it says is much less important than this muster and descriptive roll from the 6th Cavalry, dated October 27th, 3 days after Uncle Stamper enlisted in the Union Army. It tells us he enlisted for 3 years, his rank was private. It tells us that he had a dark complexion, a physical aspect of Uncle Stamper that we didn't know about previously. He was 34, and he was a farmer before he became a soldier. But the single most interesting thing about this scriptive roll is what was written in the remarks. You see at the bottom, it says, Mrs. Sally Gardner, owner. And the story that's been passed down to us is that Sally Gardner received a $300 bounty from the U.S. government in return for Uncle Stamper, enlisting. Now, it doesn't say that on this particular muster roll, but that's the story that's been passed down. And in addition, the story that's been passed down is that Sally Gardner was told that after the war, Stamper would come back to her farm. Now, we can, I think, very safely and securely say that, based on the records that we found and looked at, that regardless whether that story is true, and we will have no way of ever establishing it, Uncle Stamper had other ideas that once he got his freedom, there was going to be no way he was going to go back to the Gardner farm unless it was as a visitor, which he did a couple times, and we'll talk a little bit about that. So Sally Gardner was the widow of Ben Gardner, and the Gardners were one of the largest, if not the largest, slave owners in eastern Kentucky, and they had extensive land holdings. And Uncle Stamper and his father, Amos Gardner, and his mother, Martha Graham, and of course Green, were there on that farm. Interestingly, during the Civil War, the farm was located at a very strategic location. It was near one of the only improved north-south and east-west roads in eastern Kentucky. So it was an area that was generally contested between the Union Army and the Confederate Army. And at various times, the farm was occupied by Union troops. And at other times, it was occupied by Confederate troops. And there were even times when it was occupied by both. But interestingly, Sally Gardner was able to somehow keep the peace between the two sides and to keep her family's farm intact through the war. And whether Uncle Stamper was part of that bargain that she struck, we don't know. But again, we know from the record that, and we'll talk about this more, that he had other ideas about what was in store for him in his life. So we know Uncle Stamper was serious about two things. One was his family, and the other was fighting for his freedom. We know he was serious about his family because there were a couple times when he was at Camp Nelson where he was AWOL, which means he was absent without permission. Not from his duties in the field, fighting, but from being in camp. And We know that he was absent because he went back to the Gardner Farm a couple times. And he went back for family celebrations, for birthdays, and for other events. He made the 90-mile trip each way to do this. So we know his family was very important to him because he would not only have to make the trip, he would have to accept the consequences of it for not being on duty in the camp when he was supposed to be. We also know that he was very serious about his duties as a soldier. We know that because he participated in a very important battle in the Civil War, the Second Saltville Campaign. The Confederate salt works, the only salt works they had, were located in Saltville, Virginia. And salt was critical because in 1860 they didn't have what? Yeah, there were no refrigerators, no electricity. So if you had an army, you needed food. Armies travel on their stomach. Everybody knows that. You need food for an army, no food, no army. So there were several battles fought over salt works. One of those battles, the one preceding the Second Saltville Campaign, was the First Saltville Campaign. And in that battle, troops from the 5th Regiment, U.S. Colored Cavalry, participated in the battle. And it was in October of 1864, just a couple months before the Second Saltville Campaign. And they were beaten back. They couldn't overcome the defenses and destroy the salt works. But not only that, after the battle was over, some of the Confederate troops murdered murdered helpless, unarmed, and injured soldiers on the battlefield. And it was an outrage. So much so that even the leadership of the Confederate Army recognized it as an outrage. So Stamler fought in the Second Saltville Campaign. 2 months later, troops from the 5th U.S. Colored Cavalry, the 6th U.S. Colored Cavalry, including Uncle Stamler's Company C, went back to try to knock out the salt works. This time, they were successful. There were more than 300 soldiers that were killed and wounded as part of that campaign, but the soldiers that went back, they had a very strong resolve. They recognized what had happened a couple weeks ago, and they were serious about going in there and knocking out the salt works, and they did. And we know Uncle Stamper was part of that very important campaign. And just to give you an idea of what the conditions were like, I looked through some of the regimental reports, and some of the regimental leaders that were sending reports back to headquarters were saying things like, the expedition was hazardous and exhausting. The soldiers suffered much from the excessive cold. Many men lost by exposure to extreme cold weather. Uncle Stamper was among those who were almost lost. And in the course of the battle, he suffered very severe frostbite. So much so that eventually he received a disability discharge from the Army for the injuries he suffered in the line of duty. And that discharge was dated August 9, 1865. But here's what we know, or what we think happened based on the review of the records. So on December 18th, at the end of the Battle of Marion, and Marion was the prelude to Saltville. So if Saltville was the house in the Second Saltville Campaign, Marion was the front door. And the Union troops wanted to knock down the front door, which they did. But on the second day of that battle, the last day of that battle, Uncle Stamper got separated from his horse. And he spent the next 3 days on his feet as a soldier. And we think that contributed to the severe frostbite that he experienced. Well, you might be thinking, how does a cavalryman lose his horse? You're a cavalryman, you're supposed to be attached to your horse. Well, it wasn't that simple, especially in the colored cavalry. They had some things working against them, things that they obviously overcame, but things that were really difficult to overcome. First, the training. Their horses weren't very well trained in battle, so the horses would spook and scare easily with all the sounds and the chaos and the excitement of battle. Secondly, their equipment was inferior, generally speaking, to the equipment that a number of the white cavalry units had. The colored cavalry units were for example, equipped with the long muzzle-loading Enfield rifles, which are perfectly fine if you're a troop, a soldier on the ground, but are basically useless if you're a cavalryman. Other cavalry units were equipped with compact rifles, carbines that are perfectly suitable for and breech loading, as opposed to muzzle loading, perfectly suitable for firing and reloading on horseback. So those factors may have contributed to the fact that Uncle Stanford ultimately suffered a very severe case of frostbite and was almost lost. But he did make his way back to safety. He got the help he needed at the hospital, and was able to survive and get his disability discharge in August of 1865. We know from the pension records that he would at least three times submitted requests to have an increase. Let me go back. An increase to his pension. And we can tell from those records that he suffered all kinds of complications from these injuries, and he must have been in a lot of discomfort and pain throughout his life after the war. But that didn't stop Uncle Stamper from doing the best he could to take full advantage of the freedom that he had helped win for himself, for his family, and for all enslaved peoples. This is a grant document from the Commonwealth of Kentucky. It shows that Uncle Stamper got 500 acres of land. But I want to talk about how he got it, because sometimes you think a grant, that's something that someone gave to you. But I've spoken to the people at the Kentucky Land Office, and Kentucky wasn't giving out grants for military service during the Civil War. They stopped doing that after the Revolution. So the type of grant this was where you had to go into a county clerk's office in a county court and purchase a warrant from the county, which authorized a survey of the tract of land you were interested in buying. And then you purchased it, and the grant document finalized that patentee transaction. It finalized the sale. So this is land that Uncle Stamper purchased. He did it like a working man. It wasn't given to him. You know, consistent with everything else in his life, he had to go out and really work for it and really earn it. And that's the same with the land that he held. So we know that he ended up owning at least 500 acres of land, and he was able to utilize that land and perhaps other land that he owned to live out his life as a farmer. And we know from where we started in our presentation that his family was important to him. So he ended up living with his brother and his brother's family, including our 12-year-old great grandmother Sally Gardner. And again, I'm sure it was a great comfort to him to have his family, and that they were grateful to have him for everything that they had done for them and for the larger cause. Uncle Stamper is also memorialized on the Veterans Memorial at the Magoffin County, Kentucky Historical Society. These are photos that Cousin Jim took that show Uncle Stamper's name on the memorial. And this is another place we can visit, along with his grave site, along with Camp Nelson. This is another significant place where we have some real physical and tangible reminders of Uncle Stamper and his life. So where does this leave us? It's the end of my presentation, but hopefully it's not the end of what we do. You know, we have, I believe, a very serious and obligation and a privilege to constantly remind ourselves about how important freedom is for everyone, and to get out there and do something, however small it might be. One of the things I did was I joined Sons of Union Veterans of the Civil War in recognition of Uncle Stamper, and that's a great organization that does a lot of work, scholarships, education, Memorial Day events, and other events to keep the memories of these sacrifices alive and remind us as best we can be reminded about the value of the freedom and the liberty that we have today that these giants like Uncle Stamper secured for us. There's other organizations, the Women's Relief Corps of the Grand Army of the Republic, the Ladies Grand Army of the Republic, Daughters of the Union Veterans of the Civil War. And I'm not saying to run out and join these organizations necessarily, but if you're interested in it, do it. It's part of our lineage and heritage. It's a good thing to do. But there are other things we can do, big and small, to honor the memory of all those 209,000 plus veterans whose names are on the memorial across the street from the museum, and others, other men and women who served in the cause of freedom. So with that, I'll open the floor to questions. If anyone has any questions or comments or thoughts, we've told our nieces and nephews and our daughter that there's no food until they ask a good question. Rachel, do you have a question? Beth? Marcy?
I just wondered if, you know, what's the best place to start if people haven't, you know, if they don't know that much about their family history? What do you think is a good place to start?
Yeah, so the question, Marcy asked a question. If you don't know the history of your family, what's the best place to start? I'll speak from my experience, and I am not an expert. I am a beginner when it comes to genealogy. The place I started was with Ancestry, Ancestry.com, which is a website. You need to get a membership and join. But one of the things that surprised me was how easy it was to start to peel back the layers of all the generations and what you can find. I think that's a very good place to start. And looking closely at the records that you had. So we figured out our connection to Uncle Stamper because the 1880 federal census records in Kentucky showed Uncle Stamper living with his younger brother, you know, our great-grandfather, Granny. And when I saw that, I wondered, who's this Stamper guy? And then I did some independent research, found his name on the memorial, and then, oh, okay, Uncle Stamper was a Union Civil War veteran, and his name is on the African American Civil War Memorial. So it's just a question of being patient and starting with a source like Ancestry, and you'll be surprised what some diligence, patience, and persistence will result in. Any other questions? All right, thank you very much, everyone. Once again, I want to thank the museum. This is a great place, and this is a very special program. It's been a privilege to present the story of my great-uncle, Stamper Gardner. Thank you.